the basic difference between inoculation is and inocular resection is the resident should understand. In inoculation, we are doing a blunt dissection and following this anatomical plane between the pseudocapsule of the tumor and the normal parenchyma. So this is the inoculation. Whereas in inocular resection, we are taking a small rim of parenchyma along with the tumor. So the problem with inocular resection is this particular rim of parenchyma will be devascularized if we excise this rim of the parenchyma. So this is the basic difference between the inoculation and inocular resection. And the third one is resection, in which we take a bigger rim of parenchyma. So there has been a score which has been recently published in European Urology. Based on this score, we can have inoculation and we can have hybrid inoculation, inoculation resection and resection. So this is the score I think the resident should know, understand now, because now the surgery is evolving and we should understand these three terms. Indication for inoculation, I will say, if you have a bilateral tumors, a solitary kidney tumor with a severe CKD, and you have unfavorable nephrometry score like renal padua or score more than 10. And also if it is familial tumors in which we are expecting more recurrence tumors, and also up to surgical expertise and discretion. It is up to surgeons whether he would like to do it, he has the expertise to do it or not. Some of the contraindication I will point out here is, if you have a small tumor like T1A, a cortical tumor with normal bilateral kidney, then there is no advantage of inoculation in this patient. Then also if you have oncocytoma of chromosome RCC, in these patients you don't have a definite pseudocapsule. Then also in cystic tumors, there is a high chance of breach and spillage if you do the inoculation. Similarly, infiltrated tumors like medullary carcinoma or sarcomatoid or collecting duct, these are tumors you would not like to do inoculation. And of course, foramen growth grade 4, these are tumors in which there are high likely of breach and positive surgical margins. This beautiful paper published in General Urology have shown in inoculation versus inocular resection, you can see the positive surgical margins, the perioperative complications, the post-op kidney function decrease is lesser in the inoculation as compared to the inocular resection, as well as the trifecta outcomes are the best in the inoculation as compared to inocular resection. Now we'll just touch the various renography techniques. The basic aim of renography is to achieve hemostasis, to have good closure of PCS, to minimize the warm ischemia time, and also to have the minimum parenchymal hyperperfusion. So in open, we have a gold standard. We used to have interrupted mattress with a bolster on each side. We can do in either in the inoculation, or we can do wedge resection or a hemianophectomy. But now is the era of minimally invasive surgery. So we can use interrupted or continuous. We can use single or double layer. We can use monocryl, V-lock, or we can use V-lock suture or a monocryl suture. We can use either a laparotomy or a hemolock for avoiding any suturing knot at that end. And we can use a sliding clip rapunafi. So I just go through this one. This is my favorite one. Two layer sliding clip rapunafi. Use a 3-0 V-lock suture on a V20 needle. And you take care of the inner layer first. So I start from here. And then I keep on taking the PCS along with it. There's no need to separately close the PCS. You can take the PCS along with the small bleeders in it and keep on taking these bleeders and then come out from the other side. And you apply a hemolog over it. This is the first layer. And the second layer is, again, you take a 2-0 V-lock suture over GS21 needle and then start from one side and then keep on taking to the other side and apply a sliding clip on the other side. This will achieve a good hemostasis, and it is a continuous suture. So this is the currently the most favorite method used by the surgeons across the world. Now, you can do a single layer also, in which you just do the internal layer. The internal layer you do either with a Vicryl or a V-lock. Now, this might be essential if you are dealing with the central hilar tumors in which the closure of the capsule is not possible. And then this is a one of a described method, modified sequential pre-placed suture renography, in which you do a zero ischemia partial nephrectomy. There's no need for clamping the vessels. Can be done only in small T1A tumors, which are cortical. And you can see here, we just place two, three pre-placed sutures to the depth of the kidney below the base of the tumor. And then we cut and we just tie the suture. So this is again an evolving technique, but this was something which is there in the literature. And finally, I just want to say, whether you use an interrupted suture or a running suture, this beautiful study published in the European Urology says that there is no difference in the post-operative functional preservation. However, the operating time and the warm machine time will be lesser in the running switcher. And similarly, if you use single layer or double layer, the function post-operative will be better preserved with the single layer as compared to double layer. However, of course, the time taken for the operation and the warm machine time will be lesser. So a single layer versus double layer, there is a better renal function benefit in single layer and equal complications. And therefore, the term is less is more for renorafy after partial infection. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anup. When do you use? What are your Dr. Anup, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah.
What are your indications for double layer suturing?
So typically, I will use double layer suture. Yeah, I will use double layer, especially if there is a large corticomedullary tumor, in which I am expecting that there will be a lot of bleeding will be there. So I would like to take the internal layer first, and then I close the capsule over it. However, the single layer I will prefer if it is a cortical small tumor like T1A tumor, and I can just take care with a single layer. Similarly, in a complex hilar tumors, it is not possible to do like in a second layer because there is no capsule over it in the central hilar tumor. There you have to do modified two layers. So you can do the two layer on the poles, but in the center you need to leave it open. So this is how you have to vary your technique according to case to case scenario.
Thank you, Dr. Anup. Now we will move forward. I request Dr. Yuvaraja to give his opinion and tips and tricks about resection of cystic tumors. Resection of solid tumors is entirely different, but resection of cystic tumors is always challenging. And the role of frozen section during nephron sparing surgery and management of focal margin positivity after partial nephrectomy. I request Dr. Yuvaraja to address all these aspects of partial nephrectomy. May I request Dr. Yuvaraja?
Yeah, can you hear me, Raghu?
Yes, Yuvaraj.
Yeah. Good evening. So now, thanks for your the opportunity. The questions are the first question is what to do about the cystic tumors. So generally, the technique which I follow to remove the cystic tumors. A few important point. Number one, so try to preserve the fat on the cystic tumor as far as possible. Don't try to, peel it up from the tumor, so you may rupture the tumor. So basically, we have to avoid rupturing these tumors. Number one. Right. So the next important step which I take is that don't try to catch the tumor with your, grasper. Right. That is the second important point.
Risk of rupture.
And the third one is that we don't do enucleo resection for this type of tumor because you are very close to the wall, so you may rupture it. So generally we go a little bit 1 or 2 millimeter, even up to 4 or 5 millimeter away from the tumor. And then because these are all cystic tumors and rupturing and all those things, we don't know the consequences, but still, so oncologically it is safe to do these three techniques which I follow. One is that don't remove the fat on the tumor. Number two, don't catch the tumor directly by your progress bar or a fourth bipolar. And the third one is that try to remove the little bit more parenchyma rather than going near to the tumor, which you may enter. So these are the three things which I do. Anything else you think that it is important for cystic tumors?
Do you get a right plane 2 to 3 millimeters away from the cystic tumors? How to get into that plane, Dr. Yuvaraja?
No, I, to be honest, I go a little away from the tumor at all. So I don't go near to the tumor. I don't want to see the tumor at all.
Right. So you try to avoid seeing the tumor.
Yeah. So I don't want to see the tumor at all. So I remove a little bit more parenchyma, especially in cystic tumors. So for a solid tumor, it's a different story. So you can go near to the tumor and then you can remove, especially in the hilar lesion.
Okay. What about frozen section? How frequently?
Frozen section generally, so worldwide, it is not advised to do. It is not practiced to, wide practice to have frozen section during partial nephrectomy. That has been like only during open surgery era, we used to do it. But we do it only for medical legal reasons. Some people ask for it, so I do it. But generally, that is not valid. Suppose I do only frozen section scientific basis only when I have a doubt whether I have entered a tumor. That's all. Otherwise, we don't do that.
Will there be difference in sending the frozen section while doing robotic versus open partial nephrectomy?
Naturally, see, in open surgery, we can send the entire specimen. Here, we can't send the entire specimen because it takes time to deliver the specimen and go back and reduct the instrument. So we generally take suspicious areas from the floor of the resection than the tumor itself. So it makes a huge difference. But still, if you are in doubt that you see a yellow tissue, a cancerous tissue on the and you have a doubt in your mind, so you may have gone through the tumors, it's better to do that.
Yeah, and your visualization is also better with the robotic. It is almost like low power microscopic dissection, like 10 times magnification will be there. Probably you can identify the margins in a better way compared to open surgery.
Yeah, yeah, of course. Why open surgery also we can do that. But here, if the margin positivity, you know, if you do it a wire dissection, it's unlikely to have it.
Yeah.
So the next question is what you're asking is a focal margin positivity and frozen section, what to do on frozen section. So you're you sent the frozen section. So, but it comes as focal margin.
Yes.
So if that is the situation, if the patient is in the under anesthesia, so I would go and re-resect the base. If the patient is extubated, so we don't do that. But generally, we wait for the frozen section report if I send it, and I think I would re-resect the base.
But you don't wait for frozen section. You do the rhinorrhaphy and wait for...
We do the rhinorrhaphy, everything. We open the clamp, and in case if there is a positive margin... So we have an opportunity once again to go back and re-resect the entire area rather than, you know, keeping it in doubt in our mind and patient's mind.
Okay. Thank you, Yuvraj.
Thank you. Anything else, you know, what Sanjay does or you do it when there is a positivity?
I think all of us do the same.
Same thing. Okay.
Yes. So may I invite Dr. Sanjay Adla now to speak on tumor spillage while performing partial nephrectomy. Minimal tumor spillage versus gross tumor spillage, how to manage, how to prevent it. Dr. Sanjay?
Okay, fine. So, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, I just in addition to what Dr. Yuvraja has suggested, I tend to do a couple of things. I always put my scissors, I used to do this in open, I always point my scissors away from the lesion towards the kidney, until I am almost at the edge. So the scissors curvature is away from the tumor, both in a robotic partial as well as an open partial. That's one. Second, my left hand have Marylands, but I am frightened of using Marylands for partial nephrectomy, especially for a cystic lesion. So I use a fenestrated bipolar in my left hand. So those are the two modifications that I would add. The third one, do we do anything different? So rather than just saying that what happens when there is margin positive, let's say we cut into the tumor. Do we need to take the scissors out to clean it? Because you know that there is tumor on the scissors. Yes. And there was a study done in a animal model. So what they did is they put the scissors into a tumor. And when they took the cells off it, in around a third of them, they could culture cancer cells. And if you clean it, of course, that's done. But what they did is, if you just buzz it for about 5 seconds, a monopolar buzz of the scissors, it almost sterilizes it. So in case if you have accidentally gone into the tumor, just to prevent the cancerous cells are there, where you're going in the new plane so that they are not implanted, just buzzing it sterilizes it. So that's just another point of technique that I tend to use whenever I go into a tumor accidentally cut. Answering your two specific questions, which is the margin positivity, which is gross tumor spillage. Gross tumor spillage and gross tumor margin. So gross tumor spillage tends to happen in cystic tumors, especially if you cut into cystic tumor, suddenly you realize that all the tumor is out in the open. When the largest study that I could find is from America, from Mihir Desai and all these people did it. They looked at all their partial nephrectomy, where they looked at almost 250 partial nephrectomies, and they took out the ones that there was a spillage. This was a multi-institutional one. I was surprised to find that there were almost 18% tumors, as in accidental ruptures of cystic lesions, 18%, which I think is a bit higher than what I would, but when they followed them even up to 5 years, they didn't find any higher chances of local recurrence. So just because a cystic lesion has ruptured, that doesn't mean that there is a higher probability of a recurrence. So that's the first take home one. The second one is, if it is a microscopic margin positivity, we know that increases the chances of local recurrence, but doesn't have any impact with respect to the long-term cancer survival. So if you just notice it on the post-operative histopathology, you just keep an eye on it. You do a more intensive radiological follow-up. I do 6-monthly CT scan for the first 2 years, then I do a yearly, and you don't need to go back in. The last question, what happens if you macroscope, you're cutting through the tumor? Preferably never be in a position where you're actually cutting through the tumor. Anybody with who has done more than one partial know that the moment they cut into the tumor, the feel that you get both in an open as well as robotic, there is, it's a bit different. So once you get in, try to go underneath, because macroscopically leaving a bit of the tumor is never an oncological operation. However, if you did it and then there is a 1 centimeter positive margin when you have done it and the patient is there, again, there isn't any incidence reporting saying that they have a higher chance of metastasis. Of course, they will be having local recurrence, but there isn't any higher chance of metastasis in them. So you would think that you might have left about 1.5-2 centimeters of tumor there. You have to monitor it, and any sign that it is increasing, go back to do a partial or do a radical nephrectomy.
Thank you, Sanjay.